Okay, the Holy Spirit has asked me to post this video here. Instead of putting a post on Facebook, the Holy Spirit asked me, make this video for all the loyal viewers who have been here with you for so many years, instead of just the few new people on Facebook, right? So I'm making this video first before putting anything on Facebook, so you can get the information here first. This is extraordinary information here. We have very extraordinary. Everything is moving very, very fast right now, as I expected. So I'm just kind of going along, like I'm just surfing the wave, basically, of information. There's this wave of information that's coming, and I'm just, trying to keep my balance and surf it and enjoying the wave. But there is indeed very big news here. Quite extraordinary, everything that's going on. So, let us fasten our seat belts and prepare to be wowed by this information. It is very, very, very significant. We know in the United States, there's a big election coming up, and it's a big election for the whole entire world, actually, because it really pits the two different ideologies against each other, that global ideologies, actually, global ideologies. And the Republicans had their convention 18th through the 21st of July. The Democrats are having the convention right now, which is the 25th through the 28th, Monday through Thursday. Now, here is where things get very, very extraordinary. And let's see if how to present this information, because it's quite amazing. I was given the impression that Jesus is going to address the world on the 29th of July. How? I don't know, maybe from within, with spirits from within our spirit, so to speak. Well, it just turns out that I am going to be somewhere on the 29th, my favorite place in the world, very profound place. I was gifted this trip. I had been pointing toward this for a long time, and I had no money to do it. And so I said, ah, the whole thing's just all this information I've gotten, it's nonsense, huh? I'm not going to be there. What a letdown. I've dieted and worked out for a year, 11 months. I was given this heads up that there's going to be this opportunity, and would I want to accept it? And I said, absolutely. And so I have just come for 1 year, 11 months, just absolutely done everything in my power to prepare for this time. And then this time is getting very, very close, and I felt like it's not going to happen for me. Then suddenly, events just miraculously changed in many ways. And one of them was my cousin died in a rollover accident, and we have to go to a funeral in Los Angeles, a memorial service, on the 28th of July. And so I was saying, wow, then I have to drive right back the next day because we can't afford a hotel, really, can't even afford a hotel for one night. And I said, that's a lot of driving. I think I'm going to be wiped out. I said, it's not safe, And I mentioned this, and then I mentioned, how much I would love to go down to the desert just to relax a little bit. And then I was offered the opportunity to do so, and I jumped at it. Said, yeah, okay. And it turns out I'm going to be down in the desert, exactly where I want to be, where I was told. Quite a while ago, I was told I'm going to be at this place on a certain date. I'm going to be there, and I'm going to be there now through this just amazing circumstance. That's, miracles that took place. So, but that's just part of it. The other parts of it are that I keep getting gifted capacities to go there in the best way, and then something really amazing happened. I assumed I'm going down there to play golf. I don't know what I'm going to do. I said, why am I going down there? What's the purpose of this? He said, I know it's an extremely important trip. There's something very significant is going to happen at the end of July. I've been told this. We've reached this is the time of transition, the 24th of July. And I knew at the end of July, spiritually, something is going to happen. And so I wanted to be part of this. So I was leaving Catholic Church last Sunday, and this young priest comes in to do Spanish Mass, and he says, "Hi, how are you?" And I shook his hand, and I said, "How's your golf game?" Because I know he was a real good golfer before he became a priest. And he goes, it's pretty good." And I say, "Do you still get a chance to play?" He says, "Well, I play now and then, you know, here and there." I think he said, "I play here and there." In other words, not so much. And just before this priest appeared in the foyer of the church, I was looking at this CD for sale they had there, to take. It said Lama, L-L-A-M-A. I said, "What? That's an odd thing for the Catholic Church to have that Lama." And there was this red bird, like a Holy Spirit, but all in red. It seemed to be coming down to earth in the picture. And it looked like it was like some desert or something. I was struck by it. I said, "Oh my gosh. The red hats, the enigmas, Tibetan Buddhists, the lamas coming down to earth." And it just struck me, this is what's going to happen. So I know something really significant is going to happen at the end of July. And then I had this meeting with the priest. I respect him greatly. He's a very bright priest, very intuitive, very spiritual priest. And I walked away feeling very funny. I said, "Whoa, something isn't right." I thought, "Hey, I'm going to have a golf vacation. How wonderful. I've been working out. I'm ready for golf." But then something feels like, not so much. You know, it's just, not so much. Here and there, but not so much. I don't play so much. In other words, I've got spiritual work to do. Okay? I can't just play golf all the time. That's why I wanted to. So some reason I asked them that question. It seems like a pretty impertinent question to ask a priest. But I asked it. And he was kind of surprised by it. So then I go researching down there in the desert, golf courses, my favorite ones, and they're all closed. I check this one, it's closed. I said, "What? Okay, no problem, I'll go to these." They're all closed, and the time I'm down there, they're all closed. For aeration, quote unquote. What? Then I check this other one, my other favorite. It's closed also, can't get any time. I said, "Whoa. I'm being sent down to the desert where it's my favorite place in the world, and I was hoping to play golf because that's the most beautiful courses, you know, in the world, just spectacular. It's like a spiritual experience, and they're all closed. They're closed." So this rocked me, you know, really rocked me, and I said, "Wow." So I really started praying. What is my purpose for going down here? What is going on here? What am I going to do? I'm just going to hang out around a swimming pool or something? I mean, no. I said, it's not really to take pictures, and it's not really because I can't really go out and do much golf. I've done that, been there. There's something else going on. I have to find out what is going on. So I woke up this morning, and suddenly, somehow, it all clicked into place, what's going on, and it just rocked me. Yeah. A couple days ago, in order to explain what's going to happen there, and a couple days ago on Facebook, there was a post from Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, and an explanation. She gave an explanation about the unseen world and how she is able to see what we don't see, the unseen world, the entities, the densities of that world, and relate with them, and they come to see her just like the people in the world come to see her. She interacts with them just like she interacts with us. To her, it was all the same, all the same. She says, but our sensory perception can't see this world. It's unseen to our sensory perception. And she said, there's all sorts of realms that we don't see. And she said, they help us out. You know, we like feel them more than we can feel their presence, and they're actually come and pray. They do singing and chanting and all sorts of spiritual exercises and things. And so she says, it's different than us here, but they're not subject to the same troubles we are here. But so there is this unseen world, unseen by sensory perception. Sensory perception is very limited. Very, very. I used to see this world, actually. I used to have spiritual vision when I was young. And then gradually I lost it. But I knew it was there. And so it's like, losing is like you're blind. You know, as Jesus said, sensory perception is really severe blindness. Very much so. So, I'm going down to the desert. And I don't know anybody else going down there, really. And I don't have any friends down there that I know of. And so I say, but I know something profound is going to take place there on the 29th through the 1st of August. Just coincidentally, that's when I'm going to be there. Not a coincidence, is it? Absolutely extraordinary. I mean, I said, well, I'll just stay there a couple of days. And someone said, no, why don't you stay an extra day? Wow, yeah. So, 4 days, is that not exactly the same as the Republican and Democratic convention? 4 days? 4 days, yes, it is. So, this is what I've been told. This is what I've intuited, and this is what's coalescing, is that there is a spiritual convention taking place. A global spiritual convention taking place. And its presence may be all over the world, but it's certainly there seems to be, is going to be very much present in the desert, this area. Coachella Valley, the most beautiful place in the world, actually. Very spiritual place. If you're attuned and awake and the subtlety, I can feel the presence, a tremendous spiritual presence there in the unseen realm. Tremendous. That's why the area is so beautiful and peaceful. And there's something there that you feel the stillness and the spaciousness very strong. And yet it's not, it's also lush and beautiful, very lush and beautiful. So, it's my favorite place in the world. I think it's the most, I believe it's the most beautiful place in the world for me. And so, there's going to be a spiritual convention there, 29th through the 1st of August. And this convention is going to be in mostly in the unseen realm, in the unseen realm. Attending this convention are a great many heavyweights, the Nyingma masters, for instance, the Bodhisattvas, the Dharma kings, the Dakinis, the saints, the apostles, you know, the angels. It is a huge, huge, super important spiritual convention that's taking place. Its purpose is to inspire the world beyond politics. And to nominate formlessness for president. In other words, formlessness for present, for presence. We say president, or for presence. Formlessness for presence. Dzogchenpa for president, as I call it. Dzogchenpa for president. In other words, they're going to nominate, they're going to go through this empowerment of saying, you know, here's our candidate for your attention. The world is saying, here's this ideology, the liberal ideology for your attention. Here's the conservative ideology for attention. This convention is to say, here's this spiritual ideology for your attention. So this has been planned far in advance, because it was known that we're going to reach this polarization in the end of July, which we have, where the liberals and conservatives, there's this massive polarization in the world now. So this was well known. I knew about it well in advance. I didn't know the particulars at all. I just knew there was something very important that I could qualify for if I really, really, really wanted it. Now, what did I want to qualify for? What have I been working towards? To be a delegate to this convention from this world, from you know, those who are in this world, to be invited as a delegate to this convention. This is a goal that I've had in my life, and so I've wanted it more than anything else, and I have worked for it intensely, relentlessly. I want to attend this convention as a delegate. You could say from this world, from California, from this world, from this sensory perception realm, experiencing. So the Dharma Kings made it happen. They made it happen for me. They've made a lot of things happen for me. The strings have been pulled just astonishingly for me. We went out and did a little shopping today. My shoes fell apart on a, I hiked yesterday. I said, I need to use these shoes down there maybe. I went on a hike and my shoes fell apart. All the glue came apart and the whole shoe just was like almost in pieces. And I had to throw them away. When I got home, I said, wow. And then I ordered a new pair of hiking boots and they came in one day. I got them in one day from Amazon. And everything, I was gifted all this stuff. I don't have any money for this. So it's like the grace of God insists that I be there, really wants me there. And the Dharma Kings made it very clear, very, 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 very screamingly clear. They say, we need you there. Not just we want you there, we need you there. They need those of us from this world to attend this convention in spirit, to be there in spirit and in body in this case, and to support this. I call it the Wow Party. The Wow Party candidate, Tsongkhapa, the Wow Party candidate for president. And the Wow refers to what? Right spiritual practice. Right spiritual practice. So I realized that today, that they want me there. They're pulling all these strings to get me there. It means a lot to them, a whole lot. Yeah, I told them, well, it means a lot more to me. Right? But they said, they may say, no, it means a lot to us, believe, you know, it means that their work is getting through to us, right? Those of us that are blinded here can be reached through reason, and right spiritual practice can begin opening up towards non-dual realization. So I was wondering, well, I don't know anybody there. So what am I supposed to do? Hang around? And no, I'll be there in spirit. I'll be there in this, on the unseen realm. There'll be this tremendous spiritual convention taking place. And I'm a representative of representing all of us there. I'll be representing us, the non-dualists of the world, here as we struggle along, right? I'll be representing us there. And I'll thank them and praise them. Just like a delegate to a political convention, they represent the people back home, right? So I'll be representing you and you and you and you and you, and saying, look, you know, look, we absolutely want your help. All of your help, all of you. And we can do it. We can do it. We can do it. The key is everyday practice, of course, and the right skillful practice, full stop in the Wow. Very much so. So I went out and bought another pair of shoes today, and some socks and some sunblock. I'm thinking like a conventioneer now. You know, I gotta get my straw hat. I did buy a hat, a little kind of woven hat, nice little jaunty little desert hat kind of. And so I'm getting in the convention mode. I'm trying to bring some nice clothes, and I'm really going down there to attend this convention, even though it's not on the level of sense being seen by sensory perception. These masters are in the subtle bodies, okay. All those attending are in subtle bodies, spiritual bodies, you might call it. Now, there might be others down there attending. I don't know. And again, Jesus is set to address this convention spiritually on the 29th of July. So, I will be representing Jesus, though A Course in Miracles also. All you who study A Course in Miracles, I will most certainly be representing you there. All those Tibetan Buddhists, Hindus, you know, spiritual people from all different approaches, I'll be representing you there for sure, including most certainly A Course in Miracles and Jesus, because I've studied that for almost 40 years. Very much a part of that. I knew when I was born that the Course in Miracles would be written in my lifetime, and I knew when it was out. I told everybody there's something going to be a book that's going to change our spiritual perspective, and I knew. And then when I found it, I said, "This is it." So I'm very much a part of that. And I started in 1978 with that. Even though I'm not part of any course, community or anything like that. I'm very much a part of what Jesus' efforts here. As well as the Nyingma Master's efforts, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang, Genti, Choki, Lodro. Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang, Choki, Lodro. Jamyang, Genti, Lodro. I say, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang, Genti, Lodro. Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang, Kensi Lodro, the great, awesome Nyingma tradition. It just knocks your socks off. They're so adept. If I think about it, it brings tears to my eyes, really. So this is just, this is the big push now. It is all important right now in the world. Where we put our attention, it is all important. So we have the third candidate. They want to have this third candidacy. So we get our attention off these other ideologies and say, let's get them on this ideology. So the world's very much going towards trying to rally around something. Their ideologies tend to rally around a figurehead, right? So they may elect, some figurehead, so to speak. I say called Dzogchenpa, which is formless identity. But we'll see what happens at the convention. I'm very interested to find out in spirit. So there's so many coincidences or miracles taking place that you can't, I can't just say, oh, this is nothing's happening. No, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of indications that something very big is happening. The big spiritual push is on. So they waited until we had our first two conventions, the Republican and Democratic convention, and I'm speaking provincially for the United States, but this truly reflects globally. It reflects globally in an enormous way, an enormous way. Most of the world sides with the liberal ideology. Most of the world does. But there's still a undercurrent of conservative ideology, and it may make its last stand here in the United States. And what this spiritual convention, this WOW convention, is to provide a third, an alternative, a third option as an alternative to these other two conservative and liberal options, a spiritual option that we rally around. It's going to be very difficult to just go it alone, coming up in the world. Very difficult. Exceedingly difficult, actually. So this is something I've recognized. The Dharma Kings have move me towards more participation. My natural inclination is to be a recluse, and I've been a recluse my entire life, actually, very much so. Very much a dropout. Truly, I mean, I went years and years without even talking to anybody, except just if I have to say, I said, yeah, hello, hi, that's it. Nothing. I mean, I was in a cave for almost decades, really. I mean, I am a big time dropout, recluse. But the Holy Spirit has asked me if I could move away from that, if I'm willing to take on some more responsibility. And so I said, yeah, I believe that if that's what you want me to do, then let's do it. And so I'm trying to move out of that recluse shell by trying to, you know, dress a little nicer, present myself in a more approachable way, trying to interact with people in a more friendly and open way. And so, but I tend to go right back to, you know, naturally to being a recluse, because really very few people even understand what's being talked about here. It's just completely over their heads. And so, I mean, why struggle, hit your head against a wall, right? It's better maybe just to be quiet and be by yourself. But the Tibetan Buddhists, and they're more, they say, look, the Dharma Kings, they say there is a way to do better than that. But you really have to work at it. And the Dharma Kings all interacted with people, right, and taught and shared the Dharma and helped. So this is the tradition I'm with now, is going along with that. So I will attend this convention. That's very unconventional for me to be a delegate. I'm a delegate, part of the party, the WOW party, you know, accepted into the WOW party, which is just an enormous privilege for me. I just, I can't even, today I was just in tears. I couldn't even express it, because you have to work your way into, I mean, to be invited, you know, it's just, yeah, it's just extraordinary. It shows what, you know, really diligent work can accomplish here, what true merit based on, you know, desperate determination and dogged perseverance, and every day 24/7 trying to cultivate the viewpoint, the non-dual viewpoint of no viewpoint, you might say, no fixation, no fixated viewpoint, that bears fruit in they want you there to, you know, be a delegate. They view me as like a delegate, the way that, like, a political party would view certain delegates who are really, really hardcore. Only the real hardcore, those who believe in the party, get invited as delegates. So this means I'm they view me as very much hardcore, a solid, you know, in my convictions, in order to attend such a rarefied event. And it's true. I am solid, which only comes from everyday practice. It's just part of my, you know, spiritual DNA, is to just keep working at this. I'm very tired today, but, you know, it's 11, almost 11, or, you know, I'm taping because I have to get ready for the trip, and here I am taping. Okay, this is what it takes. I said, no, this is more important than you know, I'll have to do, I can't, this is first, everything else has to fit in around your right efforts. Yeah, this is what I believe in. I believe in everyday practice and a culture of everyday practice. This is what I support. Now, the practices can vary, of course, but not the everyday part of it. That has to take place. You cannot start skipping days. Before you know it, you're skipping weeks, and then months, and then years, and then lives. It goes like that. It's a very slippery slope. So to be just a delegate, I don't care how small of a delegate I am. I mean, if you're a delegate, you're a delegate, so you're in the door. So just to get in the door is just I can't even put into words. It's just wowish, very wowish. So I've been working towards. I know something's going to take place. And I'm trying to tell people, hey, there's this amazing conference going to take place end of July, to really set the tone for the next 4 years, 4 months, and 4 years in this world. Actually, you might say, this is the time of transition. We're going now into the time of transition here in this world. No doubt about it. So they're kicking it off. They're not going to wait to react. They're going to make a big, big push now. So this is a way to fire up the delegates, just like the political parties fire up their delegates to go out and then push the election through. So this is going to fire us up to push the election of Dzogchenpa through, which means, of course, it's our own. We elect Dzogchenpa means we elect to for Guru Vision. It's our own election. See, we decide to vote for Dzogchenpa means we're voting for formless identity, for Guru Vision, for seeing that perception is a choice, not a need. There's no such thing as victimization. These various realizations. Nothing has ever happened. None of these bodies was able to limit what we are in the slightest bit. All these attempts at definition have not succeeded in the slightest bit. We're still perfectly free. It's to see that. So that's then Dzogchenpa is then president of us, meaning present to us. He is present to us. Formless intrinsic spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness that is never modified by any of its decoration and ornamentation. So I worked out like 4 days in a row, just brutal leg workouts, and my legs are sore and hurting, and I am tired. I also did upper body workouts. I really worked out so much, and now I'm just almost collapsed. So tired from it. So I hope the body can bounce back in the next couple of days. I may have overdone a little bit. I just pray that the spirit strengthens me for this ordeal. Supposed to be quite hot down in the desert, 114 degrees on Friday, 116, 17 on Thursday. You gotta be careful in that kind of heat. I was trying to see if I could handle the heat, but I really can't very well. Which is another thing. I said, "Uh-oh. Well, maybe I'm just gonna hang out inside." It's just being there that's important. It's just being there, just attending the convention is what's important. A spiritual convention on the subtle levels. They're not really levels in reality, but just a subtle meaning we can't see it with our sensory perception, the body sensory perception. We can't see it, but we can be aware of it spiritually. And you may be able to attend it right where you are. But in this case, it's important for me to be in a certain place. Maybe the headquarters, for this. One of the headquarters for this, or at least a branch office for this, next 4 months and 4 years, until the 2020 election. Very likely to be a time of immense turmoil in the world. In fact, it's going to be. It's called the turnover times. Are the time of transition, turnover times. And I can hardly tell you the number of heads up I've gotten about this. Not only my cousin dying in a turnover accident. People suddenly saying, "Hey, look at this video. It shows somebody turning over 14 times in a vehicle. Rolled over, turnover." What it means, this is symbolic for the times we're entering. In a turnover, you lose traction, ordinary traction. The wheels are off the ground, and then you can't steer the car at all. So you're out of control, and the car is going over and over, and you're being thrown this way and that way inside the car. I mean, the seatbelt doesn't really keep you in very well. It's supposed to, but you need a 5-point harness to keep you in. Otherwise, you get thrown out of the seatbelt actually in lots of different ways. Your up, especially your upper body. And so it means a time when we're getting tossed here and there in a way which we can't control. And we're being battered by very tumultuous times. So we're set to be battered by very tumultuous times. Like a rollover accident. And I don't doubt that this will happen. I don't doubt it at all. Someone asked me, well, when are you going to Tibet? And also, I was asked going down there, it's like my passport expired. And I said, well, that's okay. The Tibet, some private plane will take us to Tibet. And I said, why am I saying this stuff? I don't know. There's really something that the Tibetan Enigma, the Tibetan masters and bodhisattvas, which we pay homage to them, to say the least. To say the least, it's really, I can't really express it in words. You talk about dedication. You talk about a dedicated group to encouraging everyday practice and the right austerities and encouraging success, and they're just phenomenal. They're like the heart, the heartbeat of the spiritual body. They keep the blood circulating. They keep the Dharma circulating. So I got this, like I said, my hiking shoes. Just here's a tip. I got them used on eBay. Like, I don't know how old they are, 6 years old or more, maybe even 10 years old. They looked in brand new condition, but guess what? The glue fails after a number of years. It didn't used to be that way. I tell you this, I used to wear shoes. I remember a pair of Adidas I had 10 years or more, and they were still solid. I mean, the glue never came off. So we have, everything is junk now. This is true. Everything is junk. Talked to a man today. He was telling me about this super expensive products he was having to use, install. Super, and he showed me, and he says, it's junk. It's junk. He says, everything is junk. Doesn't matter how much you pay for it. In fact, the more junk it is, the more you pay for it, make you feel better about it. It's all junk. The quality is so terrible. Anyway, all the glue just completely failed on me. So I then ended up getting this brand new pair of hiking boots, which are really, really good. Supposedly, rated super, super high. They won the Editor's Choice Award, and this, they won a lot of awards. I said, okay, let me get. I've never had a good pair of boots in my life, really. Nothing but junk in a lot of ways. And now I have a pair that of, considered really nice. Day trip, not long, heavy pack sort of hiking boots. You need more heavy, stable, heavier boots for that. But like a day trip with a light pack. Day trip with a back, 30-pound pack or 25 or whatever. They're supposed to be very, very excellent for that. So I have those. I have those. I said, wow. Then I got a pair of just good regular, walking about town shoes, just basic, kind of real sturdy athletic shoes, for really cheap today on clearance. I think they're like $39 or something. It's like they're made really nice. I said, oh, thank you, God. So I'm getting, shoes, nice shoes to wear. So I have these hiking shoes. What do I need to use hiking shoes for? I don't know. But they keep saying, well, Tibet. Well, what? I don't know. It's somewhat of a mystery at this time. And I tell you this, that the this overall, plan to help us in the world, it's on a need to know basis. And so I don't really know the details. I know there's something going on, And bit by bit, on a need to know, I'll know what I need to know, and not much more than that. But I know that, like, going on a hike is a very good bond, spiritual bond for people. And so maybe I'll be going on hikes or leading hikes at some point in my life. I don't know. I'm not a very good hiker, but I could work out and, you know, maybe, you know, get that way. My legs are getting pretty stronger. So, you know, maybe I'll do that. So I don't know what's going to happen. Don't know, except we're headed for these turnover times. So you can bet, don't ever sell the Dharma King short. Don't ever sell the Nyingma Master short. Don't bet against them. Do not bet against them. See, I looked at my date that I was born. There was this book I found that it listed, you know, in history, every date going back quite a ways, but it had my year and the date of my birthday, which is the same as President Clinton. We share the same birthday. we were eating dinner tonight, and there was these TVs at a restaurant, and one of them had a baseball game on, and the other had Bill Clinton addressing the Democratic Convention. It's like, there's no sound on either one of them. And I looked at the baseball game, I said, I'm not into baseball anymore. I looked at Clinton, I said, no, I'm not into Cousin Bill anymore. No, I mean, we had him for 8 years, you know? And he's been gallivanting around with his quote-unquote foundation, which is, you know, money-making scam, for 16 years. And now we're supposed to accept him for probably 8 more years. Are you kidding me? That's 32 years of Bill Clinton in the United States. You know what? You know, whatever you feel about him, that's too many years of Bill Clinton. I'm sorry. He's not a repentant mind. Okay? He hasn't repented. He's can put on that act of being very pious and compassionate. And he's a great, you know, eloquent, rhetorician, you know, he looks very dapper in a nice suit and blue tie and this white, nice, I don't know how much his haircuts off, $500 or $250 or whatever. I mean, a little expensive haircut, and, you know, he's just, you know, filthy rich. And, but, you know, we know what he's about. We know what he's about. I mean, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Put him back in the White House? No. Enough's enough of the Clintons. We know their act, and it didn't play very well, actually. So anyway, but I'll give him a hug. You know, same birthday, and you know he has skills. If he repented, he would be really great. You know, he's got greatness in him, but he's not repentant. He hasn't repented. He says, why do I need to repent? You know, all the ladies really love me and think I'm wonderful, and I could really wow them with my looks and come and, you know, talk the talk they want to hear about it. It's yeah, I said, Uncle Bill, Cousin Bill, you know, come on over to the light side. Okay, the right side. Come on over. The water's fine over here. So I'd welcome him, but I don't want to welcome him to the White House. I don't. Anyway, yeah, you know, just no, nothing politics, nothing of this. Forget it. No baseball, no politics. We'll focus in on the Nyingma Masters, and the Bodhisattvas and the Dharma Kings and what they can do, what they can do. But I understand him having the same, you know, birthday. He was born, I think he's a couple years older than me, a little bit. I understand him. His personality, how he is. But I tell him, hey, you know, you got to be careful with that kind of personality. You have a lot of charisma. You better be careful how you use it. You better hook up with some spiritual mentors. If you don't, you're going to be a Pied Piper for darkness, actually. For spiritual positivism, spiritual materialism, which is a Pied Piper for that. Which is a bad thing, very bad. So, yeah, people bored on, well, it was said, I looked in this book, it said, on that exact date in history, astrologically, doing an astrological chart of it all and all this kind of stuff, they said, you're either going to be a great gambler or a brain surgeon. I said, well, I'm both. I turned out to be both. I've done surgery on my mind, so to speak, right? And I've gambled on the Dharma Kings. You know, that's a great gamble. In other words, a great gambler really is able to assess the odds. Really able to assess the odds. And they make the right play. And I said, don't sell the Dharma Kings short. Okay. They got the answer. They have the answer. They have the winning hand. They can't miss. They can't miss. They can't lose. So I align with them. That's being, we all are gamblers, speculating like what's going to happen in the future and what should we do, right? So I gambled on the Dharma Kings and I gambled on the Holy Spirit and I put my money down on Jesus. So I am a great gambler. There's no question about it. That book turned out to be true. I was like rather astonished. So a great gambler puts their money down on the winning side. Otherwise, they wouldn't be a great gambler. So there you go. Now today, just before this convention, I had a tremendous insight. It's the kind of insight that you're looking for—a simple insight that just settles it all. And it goes like this. If you're still with me, what's the time here? 47. Okay. If you're still with me here, congratulations. That's great because we have something here for you. So I don't go to the delegate empty-handed. I may be the least of them there. Probably am the very least. But at least I'm there. And what did Jesus say? The least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than the greatest who are still, you know, denying the kingdom of heaven. So, I may be the very least there, probably am, but boy am I grateful to be there. And I certainly am not at a loss for words or some clarity. So, the gist of the insight, the breakthrough, was that all of our defenses are extremely complex. We have massive complexity in our defense, which really is just, we're trying to define what we are. Okay, we're really at absolute freedom. And of course, absolute freedom can't possibly be defined because we're just as free to be anything else as we are this. So how could you say, well, this defines me? Nothing defines absolute freedom at all. But yet we're trying to define what we are and attempt to limit ourselves to say that we can limit reality and fixate reality so we can say that we changed reality and we're greater than reality. It all has to do with us wanting to be greater than God. So we have made all these super complex, clever, insidious defenses to trick ourselves into not being aware of reality and believing that all these forms somehow define what we are and that something's happening. There's nothing happening. There's nothing defines what we are. But we have enmeshed ourselves in this belief system, okay? Very severely. And very complex. This is what I found out. And today I said, look, I'm not into complexity. In fact, one insight settles all of this instantly. None of it works. We can't all definitions of what we are equally flat and nil, invalid. All of them are equally invalid. Even if there's trillions upon to the trillionth power of attempts to define what we are, they're all null and flat, from the very beginning. They're all equally, totally invalid. And that's true this instant. It's true this instant. And therefore, that just settles it all. Right now, settles it all. Super simple. Now, the ego says, whoa, 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 wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. You can't do it that way. And the ego says, look, I put up all this complexity. Okay, and so you have to go through this complex. You need a complex answer to a complex question. This is the ego saying this. And I said, ego, one insight settles it all. There's no complexity to zero. And the ego says, but I've made zero so complex. I said, no, you haven't. And the ego says, no, you've got to, I won't accept a simple answer to a complex situation. And I said, the situation is not complex. And the ego says, well, yes, it is. So it is and it isn't, right? It depends on, you know, your viewpoint. It's much ado about nothing. So how complex can we that be in reality? Within, at the level of delusion, it's complex. Of denial, level of denial. But at the level of reality, it's not complex at all. It's just nothing. It's nothing. There are no definitions that define us. So we don't have to sort through all these definitions and say, well, this one's a little better than that, and this is worse than that. And these two together help out a lot. Those two over there don't really get along so well. It's not helpful. This is what we're doing. Is what we think is life is just sorting through all these definitions. That's all we're doing mentally. Categorizing them, grouping them in this way and that. Coming together and say, let's put these two definitions together and see what we can make of that. What comes of that? Let's put these definitions over here. Let's move these over here in space. Put these over in space. In other words, different areas of space. So these definitions can be seen to be different than these definitions. That's called space. Space is just time and space is just mental. Mental made it up. It's all imagination in the mind. So you can make it seem separate. Like this definition and this is higher. This one's lower. All we're doing in the realms of dream, of levels, layers and levels, and form and all this, is just playing with definitions, trying to make it meaningful, to come up to generate meaning. Well, guess what? It's meaningless. It's meaningless. And what is meaningless right now. We don't have to wait for it to lose meaning. It's meaningless right now. So the ego says, no, you have to have a complex answer to a complex question. I say, well, where's the complex question? The ego says, well, how are you going to get through all these defenses? And I say, you don't have to go through them at all. We don't have to sort anything out. It's all sorted out completely. It's all null and void. It's meaningless, completely meaningless. And it's all equally meaningless. So that's the end of it, ego. And I'm not into failure. I'm not really into failure. This is the end of it for you, the ego. You're the one that failed, right? So seeing that the ego is simply rejects any simple answer and says, no, you can't have a simple answer to a complex question. This is the ego's logic. You cannot have a simple answer to a complex question. The ego thinks it's made the question very complex. No, it hasn't. It hasn't done anything. What question? It's just sorting out. Everything it sorts out is all on the same equal level. There's no differentiation at all in relation to reality. The idea that reality can be defined, it doesn't matter what what definition we use. That's zero, null, void. Same as all other attempts to define. All void from the very beginning. Spontaneously void. Void without any effort. Void without any time needed to void it. Okay, void without any time needed to void it. So, when you go to a convention as a delegate, you represent the folks back home, a certain minds, you know, certain constituency, etc. So hopefully I can represent all of you well. Because this is what we're into here, right? Void without needing any time to void it. Void without needing to void it. No space in which to void. We don't need space to void it. We don't need time to void it. It's void from the beginning. Spontaneously void. Spontaneous means it doesn't need time or space. It arises spontaneously as voidness. Void without a need to void it. Meaningless without a need to make it meaningless. All definitions of what we are, voidness, without a need to make it void. Without having to void it. Void without voiding it. Void without having to void it. Wow. Void without having to void it. 124 in Death Valley. Coming up here, folks. Something like that. That's not far from the world record. What's the world record? 134, 135, something like Death Valley, something like that. I would think it would have gotten hotter at some point. Maybe this summer it will. Hot August nights. If possible. Although July usually has maybe the hottest days. I don't know. August could be pretty hot, but it's starting to taper down a little bit. But who knows? We may set a world record this year. If so, I want to be there. But I don't know. It might melt the tires on the vehicle. You know, you might not get out of there alive. There should be like some refrigerant system in the wheel wells that as the wheels turn around, it keeps the tires cool. They could do that. They could do all sorts of stuff. Void without a need to void it. It's very warm here today, very apocalyptic. It broke the century mark here. 101. They keep getting it very wrong. They said it'd be like 86 here today. I mean, that's missed it by 15 degrees. That's pretty nice. Maybe some said 89. But they missed it by 10 degrees, basically. They've been missing it by 10 degrees the last four or five days. Every day they miss it by 10 degrees. How is that possible? I mean, you could throw a dart at a dartboard and do as well. What in the world's the matter with the meteorologist today? Where's the professionalism? Gone. It's either a kid in his underwear in his mom's basement or a yoga girl doing the weather. I mean, they must think that, you know, hey, I don't really need to be that accurate. I'm so cool. It's, you know, I really don't need to take responsibility for anything. And so let's just say this. They don't care. If you got it wrong, I can't. The weather forecasting has gotten atrocious. It used to be way better than it is now. Way, way better. And you need to count on it. I mean, if you're going to take a hike, for instance, a big difference between 86 and 101. One, you get heat stroke. The other, you have a good time. So, when there's a heat spell, you can't miss it like this. That's just horrible what they've been doing. It's dangerous. Very dangerous. It used to be they'd get it within a couple degrees. Now they're just so sloppy. I guess like all the products these days are even higher quality products are just sloppy. Everything's sloppy. Everything's, you know, fayuca, junk. Including the weather forecast. So we'll see how hot it really is down there. Maybe it'll be even hotter. I don't know. And then we'll get a monsoon. Supposed to come in Saturday and Sunday is a monsoon. This is quite extraordinary. They say that the sky, the clouds, I was told what to look for. Look for the sky, spaciousness, the sky. because all the fires in California, today the atmosphere in the Bay Area was so weird. I've never seen anything so weird. The sun turned in this vast, huge orange ball. And it was just this sort of grayish cloud cover. And I said, where does this come from? It's got to be from the fires somehow. And down south, they have a lot of big fires. It's the and so you mix the smoke with monsoon coming from the Gulf of Mexico, and you're likely to have some spectacular skies and sunrises, sunsets, and just general amazing cloudy conditions down to the desert you don't see very often. I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to the rain, actually. It's supposed to rain thunderstorms. Oh, that's really cool. Can you imagine going from 115 to thunderstorms? And talk about the evaporation. I mean, that'll just be unbelievable. I mean, the asphalt, it must be 135 or 40. I mean, if it's 115 in the air, the concrete, everything, the buildings absorb so much heat, and then all just to pour water on top of all that, 150 degrees, 130, 40 degrees, just pour water over everything. I mean, you're gonna have a sauna. It's gonna be ridiculous. If I hope, just everything just like dripping and steaming, and I mean, even the jungles, you don't get 115. Like it's 80, it's humid, it's hot, it's 85, and but 115 in a thunderstorm, wow, that's gonna be an unusual experience. Even though it may have cooled off, but by that day down to 105 or something, but there could be some come in. The heat is on, isn't it? The heat is on. Very apocalyptic feeling today and this evening. Extremely so. Extraordinarily weird atmosphere in the Bay Area right now. Very apocalyptic. It is. I've never seen anything like it, actually. It's very warm this evening. It just everything feels on edge, doesn't it? It really does. It's just don't worry at all. The masters know what they're talking about. They know that all this attempt to identify what we are is equally futile. There's nothing to pick or choose from whatsoever, so you can drop it all this instant. One insight settles it all this instant. And ultimately, this is the realization. You say, wow, I spent my whole life, the ego has fooled me. My entire life, I've been fooled. I say, well, I've got to, must be a very complex answer to this, because it's such a complex question. And so we keep looking in the wrong place. We keep looking in the direction of complexity. But what non-dual does is has us look in the direction of utter simplicity. One insight, one simple insight settles it all. What does settles all mean? It means that any and all definitions that could ever arise, any attempt to define, is all equally meaningless, and there's nothing to pick or choose from whatsoever. And so we can just drop the whole thing this instant, all together as one. Just poof, that's it. So I have a pair of hiking shoes, not like a heavy duty trek, with the real heavy boots, high ankle heavy boots. This is a mid ankle, super lightweight that people use it to hike the Appalachian Trail, for instance. It's starting to be very popular for the Appalachian Trail hiking. It can handle anything, but if you're wearing like a 80-pound pack or real heavy. You might go for a heavier boot, but this is supposed to be, be able to handle anything, mid-ankle, super lightweight, really nice. So that's a hiking boot. Then I have a walking shoe, athletic walking shoe, which is stiff suspension to it. It's good for just walking, like on just, simple trails and paths, with some rocks, etc. Not too rugged. It's just a good walking shoe, but not for rugged terrain. Well, these other ones can handle all types of trails, as well as streams, is waterproof also. So that's how. So I have a walking shoe, hiking shoe, walking shoe. Then I have a just a general purpose, like a athletic tennis shoe, that's somewhat. It's not a runner. It's in, but it's just really comfortable for like driving. You might call it a driving shoe, walking around in stores, walking around places, that kind of shoe. Very comfortable. And then I have a running shoe. Very lightweight, very stiff suspension as far as running. It's a very advanced running shoe. I don't run that much, but if I do, that's the one I use. So I have those, different shoes now: hiking, walking, driving around town, and then running. Now, any one of these shoes can be used in the other applications if you have to. But and then I have a pair of golf shoes. And a pair of dress shoes is kind of a cheap pair of dress shoes, and hopefully I don't have to go to many funerals. So I don't try to get fancy with dress shoes. So it feels like the apocalypse now. It may very well be the apocalypse. It's the turnover times. It's the time of transition. And the good news is, again, that we have this great help available to us. And they're super dedicated. They have a plan to help us. They're not just sitting back and they're not they're proactive. They're not going to just, well, let's just see how it turns out. No, they know how it turns out if we don't get to get down to practicing. So they're going to, help us out a great deal. One insight settles it all. You should let that be your motto, practicing motto, that we don't need a complex resolution to a complex question, because the question really isn't complex. It's very simple. How do we define ourselves? And the answer is, we can't. So you don't go to need to go any further than that. Well, what do we do with all these symbols? Well, they're just symbols. You don't need to do anything with them. I better go to sleep. It's been a very stressful time, say the least. Super stressful. So I'll get a rest and get ready to wear my delegate hat. So I'm going down there in a very positive mood, like a delegate to a convention. It's like, wow. Usually it held a nice place, and delegates hang out for a week or so, and they go to restaurants, they kind of relax, chit chat, exchange information. So I'll give out press releases, hopefully, from the convention, on the page, Zogchenpa for President, facebook.com/Zogchenpa for President. It's Dzogchenpa. Zog. It's Dzogchenpa for FOR President. Facebook/Zogchenpa for President. Like the page. I think someone has liked the page. Maybe a couple people have. This way it shows up on your news feed. Whatever's there, it's in your news feed, so you don't miss it. I've liked some pages, and it shows up real nicely, and you go through, and of course if you friend someone, but this is not a person, so it's a page, so you have to like it. And you could You can post on that page. It's open. You know, if there's something that's off target, then I'll have to take it off. But for the most part, you know, you can comment and a picture and stuff. I'm pretty relaxed about that. Pretty tolerant. You know, there's some lines that you don't want to cross. I don't like pictures of bodies, if it can be helped. You know, minimize it. Just use the Dharma Kings. If you have to use a picture of a Dharma King. For the most part, it's not, but certainly, in animals, pictures of animals and bodies. No, no, thank you, please. Those are just attempts to define what we are. So let's not include those. So press releases, what's going on from the convention, live from the convention. And see, you know, what comes of it, and see the momentum we can garner. So there's this period of the convention that, where there's sort of a little lull as far as, you know, what's going to happen. The momentum will get going after the convention is over, and we have our marching orders as to how do we help those who want to be helped, turn to the right ideology, which liberates us ultimately from rebirth, right? I mean, what is rebirth except an attempt to limit ourselves? And even more, you could say, attempt to sort out all these attempts to limit ourselves so we can finally come across a way to do it. Say, okay, well, I haven't quite done it yet, but we're getting there, so let me find a way to order all these different attempts and sort it all out, like compute, you know, go put it all through a computer, and maybe I can come up with the answer. That's called another life, another round of an existence, cycling through existence. It's trying to sort out definitions of what we are and make heads or tails of it all. And the answer is, don't try to sort it out. Don't try to make heads and tails of it all. It's all null and void. It's all zero from the very beginning. It's zero now. It's zero from the very beginning. It always will be zero. So we certainly don't need to take a birth and have, you know, try to limit ourselves with a body. Once we realize this, right? It's all zero. It's all nothing at all. Null and void. All attempts to define what we are in a completely null and void, then why do we need to sort through any of it? So we certainly don't need to be sorters, evaluators, measurers, label conceptors, that stuff. So we don't need, that's it. That's the end of all this, the cycles of existence. Very simple. One insight settles it all. I might play a little golf. I don't know. Depends how I feel. Depends how things go. I have an open mind. I'm not committed. I don't have any reservations or anything. I just, you know, do whatever's best. Whatever I feel is this is going to, spiritually is the best to do, then I can do it. But I don't think I want to go out in 114 degrees. I did. I already did once. Did it once. 113, 114. Was very interesting. You have to limit your exertion very carefully. Very carefully. Walk slowly. It's, boy, you cannot function the way you're used to functioning. That is for sure. Gotta have ice on your head, ice on your neck, ice, ice. And you're tired afterwards. It saps you of energy. So, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I'm already sapped from trying to hike in 100-degree temperature. And almost passing out in earlier on Sunday in an earlier workout from almost having heat stroke. So I feel a little, you know, rocked by that. But hey. Should be interesting. Okay, so I really recommend Facebook. I don't know if you have to, yeah, I guess you have to sign into Facebook to read it, don't you? Maybe not. I don't know. You might be able to just go to facebook.com/Zogchen for president. Dzogchenpa for president. Might be able to go to that. Now you can't post if you're not signed into Facebook. You can certainly read and click on the videos probably. But I'll keep an open mind as to what I do. Very open-minded. Subject to more information. Now, the people I'm meeting right now are very interesting. I've met a number of people recently who really ties into what's going on in a lot of ways. So there's an attraction. Maybe these are fellow delegates that I'm meeting, you know, that are also going to attend this, maybe in some other part of the world. So big, big, big stuff is happening in the world now. Super mega stuff is happening in the world. And it's all going to get underway now. Once the Democratic Convention closes shop, full blast campaigning now. I mean, they've got August, September, and October. They have 3 months. I don't know why they hold their convention so late. It's weird. They only have 3 months. I would hold a convention earlier. Less time on the primaries and more time, you know, actually campaigning. 3 months is not enough time to get your message out clearly to everybody. I don't know. That seems a rush, 3 months. But this is what it's going to be. It's a 3 month rush to the finish line. But we're bypassing the 2016 election, aiming for the 2020. 2016 to now, this is just going to be turmoil coming. Very bad turmoil coming. So, you know, having good shoes is a great help. The Holy Spirit also says hydrate a lot. Drink a lot of fluids. Stay hydrated. So I'm doing that before I go to the desert. Stay starting to drink a lot of fluids, a lot of electrolyte drinks. A singer once told me, it takes a couple days to hydrate yourself. You need to like drink a lot of water, a lot of fluids for a couple days before your body's really fully hydrated. And he says you can sing a lot better when you're really hydrated. It's the number one key to good singing. Speaking of good singing, I was singing today, most of the day, to the Beach Boys. Why not? Never heard anyone sound better. And that was a blast. I really had a lot of fun with that. I was singing alternative lines, emphasis, harmonies, alternative harmonies with the Beach Boys, spontaneously, and able to add. I'm good at singing down, meaning I start a higher pitch and then drop the line down. Most singing kind of tends to go up and down. I'm able to really good at going dropping it down, and it's a whole different sound when you do that and you harmonize with the Beach Boys, who are tending to go up, and I start high and go down. Wow, that's a really cool sound. It's a different sound. I mean, it makes it sound different and unique. I wouldn't say it makes it sound better, but it certainly gives a really cool sound. Well, since you put me down, I've been out doing in my head. Like that. Since you put me down, I've been out doing in my head. You know, dun 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 dun. So dun 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 dun. He said, well, since you put me down, I've been out doing in my head. And so I do a little more going, you know, lower in the scale. I tend to be able to do that, and it's a skill that I've actually worked on a bit. Most singers don't do that, but I found out when you do that, it gives a whole different feel to the singing. So I was doing that. I was doing hitting the high notes early in the day. Once my voice gets tired, I can't hit the high notes anymore. That's okay. Yeah, you know, the singing voice is pretty good, doing pretty well. So pretty good with fitness, singing, pretty good all around, good enough to attend the convention, right? After all, I'm the least of the attendees, so it's not like I have to be super, I'm not a super delegate as far as I know. Maybe I'm a super positive delegate, but maybe not one of these super delegates. So I don't have to be, wow anybody. I just have to show up. Just be there. As I say, the greater part of success is just showing up, right? The greater part of success is just showing up. So I will do that. Now, most of us, we feel like, oh, no, we're all too much idiots to show. Well, yeah, we are. We're idiots, right? Of course, but we're just caught up in trying to sort it all out. Well, there's nothing to sort out. That's all. So once we see through this, then we're not really idiots anymore. We say, whoa, wait a minute. I don't need a complex answer because there's really no complex question. The question is, how do we sort it all out and figure out, meaning? And I say, well, there's no meaning. It's all meaningless. We keep the premises. There's meaning here. And so we think that all this intellectual effort we're making is somehow helping us arrive at the answer, at meaning, at definition. It's not helping us arrive anywhere. It never got started. No definition ever got started. So all this idea we're going somewhere, we're not going anywhere. So you just get familiar with this and hear it, hear it, hear it, hear it, hear it, hear it, hear it. Ramaharshi said, what I have done, you surely can do as well. Absolutely, surely you can do this. Yeah. Okay, now I'm getting really tired. I better wrap this up. My energy's like dropping too much. Okay, so there you have the news. A member of the WoW party. A member of the WoW party. That's great. I always wanted to be a member of that party and no other. So it's terrific. Okay. And again, facebook.com/Tsongkhapa for president. Like the page, you get the feed. And don't be shy. Don't be shy. It's no time to be a complete recluse. Not really. Because the turmoil to come. It's great to be aligned with the Dharma kings, and whatever tradition you have, it's great to be aligned with them, and really feel. And they've told me that we need you, we want you, we need you, and really, we hope you say yes. That is for sure. They tell me we really want you to say yes. I say, wow, okay. Means a lot. When someone wants you like that, it means a lot. So see if you can in your dreams, in your life, if you cannot align with something that is way clearer than you are, that can help, take you under their wing and keep you safe during this time of turmoil. Like in a storm, the birds might shelter, and their wings shelter the little birds, so that they don't get all soaked. Because the birds have big feathers that are all waxed, and the water runs off of them, and the little ducklings have just down. It kind of can get wet. It's supposed to keep warm, but wet's not so good. So they can shelter us from the storm. It's all about a Dharma refuge. This convention, the projects are about Dharma refuge for those who are seeking the truth, and awakening, going in an awakening direction. Direction of awakening to the simple fact that there's the meaningless doesn't have any layers or levels to it. So it's already undone. There's nothing to undo. It's already flat. It's already realized to be nothing at all. It's inherently realized. Realization is something that's already inherently true. It's already inherently so. So it's the absolute, voidness without having to make it void, absolute simplicity without having to make it simple. Okay. Wow. Very great. So, don't have much more time before we head out. So, okay, stay tuned, and I don't know how much I'll be able to post taping or whatever I'll do. I don't know. If I don't tape a lot, then I'm just real busy dealing with what's happening. And but you'll find out for sure. Hopefully, I can keep you posted every evening, every day, evening in some way, to just kind of feel the ambience of what's going on. All right, very great. That's it for this one.